Hello friends, in my this video I am going to give you some insights about discrete Fourier transformation. Already in my previous video I have shown you for a particular given sequence how you can calculate discrete Fourier transform or fast Fourier transform and how to plot the magnitude and phase part. I will provide the link of my previous video in the description box. Please check that as a prerequisite of this video. So what is DFT? We know from the theory that DFT is basically sampling in frequency domain. We have the frequency axis, we divide it into n equally spaced slots, and that we call as endpoint DFT or endpoint FFT. The formula is well known and is given by x of k is equal to summation over n equal to 0 to capital N minus 1 x of n e to the power minus of j 2 pi k capital N k by capital N into n, where k varies from 0 to capital N minus 1. And here if we see our well known unit circle, whatever we have dealt with this particular circle in J transformation, see here you know that this starts from 0 rate, that is 0 or DC frequency, and our digital frequency point of interest is 0 to pi. Okay, here if we go here, we will get pi by 2, then pi, then 3 pi by 2, again 2 pi or 0, that is same frequency only, that is DC frequency. This pi corresponding to our Nyquist frequency, that is here the analog frequency equal to fs by 2 or sampling frequency by 2, which is called Nyquist frequency. This I have already discussed in my previous video where I have told you about analog and digital frequency. Please check the link given in the description if you want to know the detailed explanation. Anyway, here also after some time I will discuss about this. Okay, so here instead of going from 0 to pi as a continuous part, what we will do, we will divide into some discrete parts. Okay, so our 0 to 2 pi, this whole range, whole complete range, we will divide into n parts. So as a result, our distinct values of omega will be here, if I have denoted using theta, that is 2 pi by capital N into k. Suppose k equal to 0, that will denote 2 pi by capital N into 0, that is 0 frequency. Then next one will be 2 pi by N into 1. Then next will be 2 pi by N into 2, so on. And after this rotation, when k value will be N minus 1, this will denote this particular sample, after which you will again encounter 0 frequency. That is, this particular frequency is 2 pi by N into N minus 1. Now you may think, why my range of k is from 0 to capital N minus 1, why not N? Because if my k value is N, simply put k equal to N here, theta of k will be 2 pi by N into N, that is 2 pi. 2 pi means 0 only, that is DC frequency only. But DC frequency we have already taken while taking k equal to 0. So in a same spectrum, we are taking same frequency twice, once at k equal to 0, once at k equal to 1, N. This should not happen, so that we have removed k equal to N and our k range is 0 to capital N minus 1. That's what we have written here. Why k not equal to N? Because at k equal to N, omega or theta or angle, whatever you say, or frequency is equal to 2 pi by N into N, that is 2 pi, that is DC, which is already taken. Alright, so I hope you just got a quick recap of the DFT. Basic physical interpretation, that is, we sample in the frequency domain and then we take the we calculate the DFT for this particular distinct points. Okay, that is omega equal to 0, omega equal to 2 pi by N, omega equal to 2 pi by N into 2, and so on, up to omega equal to 2 pi by capital N into N minus 1. This you can take as angle also. This one is 2 pi by N, next will be 2 pi by N into 2, like that angle notation also, some books it is taken, so that I have shown the angle notation also. Alright, now k value for our area of interest. See, just recall the derivation, whatever we have done in analog and digital frequency. I have told you that our sampling frequency greater than equal to 2f max, 2 into f max, that is, this is a sampling theorem, well known sampling theorem. So from here we can say our frequency, input signal frequency, should be 0 less than equal to f max less than equal to fs by 2. multiply 2 pi in the whole equation, you will get 0 less than equal to 2 pi f max less than equal to 2 pi f s by 2. And this is our analog frequency. So our analog frequency range is 0 to pi f s in the unit of radian. Now multiply capital T, or this is called sampling time in the equation. You will get 0 less than equal to analog frequency in radian multiplied by sampling time less than equal to pi fs into t. Now fs is sampling frequency, capital T is sampling time. Sampling time into sampling frequency is equal to 1, and this particular analog frequency into sampling time is equal to digital frequency. Already I have discussed. Please check the description link of the video where I have discussed analog and digital frequency. So our digital frequency is 0 to pi, okay, and this is our point of interest which we have encountered in the plot of DTFT and digital filters also, right? Now when omega is equal to 0 and when omega equal to pi, for which value of k omega equal to 0, for which value of k omega equal to pi? Simple, omega equal to 0 means 2 pi k by n equal to 0, because 2 pi k by n is our discrete omega values for our DFT, so that is equal to 0. 2 pi n, anything cannot be 0 or something, only k has to be 0. So k equal to 0 is our minimum area of interest, k value, and for maximum, omega equal to pi, that is 2 pi k by capital N equal to pi, that is k equal to n by 2. So always in the DFT, our point of interest should be 0 to n by 2, okay? So if I show like this, so 0 to n by 2, we actually calculate DFT for 0 to n minus 1. Okay, k value varies from 0 to capital N minus 1 for n point DFT. But our point of interest should be this much only, that is 0 to n by 2. And it is quite clear that, see, 0 to pi, our digital frequency may vary. That means our maximum frequency in case of discrete signal may go up to pi, and minimum one is 0. 0 is low frequency part, pi is higher frequency part. Obviously, it is quite clear. So we can say our this particular region always indicates what? Low frequency component in the DFT, and close to this particular part, close to n by 2, this particular region indicates high frequency part. Okay, this is another very important conclusion. Now simple code for DFT I have written. If you have watched already my previous video, this is very simple, you can understand it very easily. CLCL clear and close all. If you want, you can write winding off also. Then I am calculating 16 point DFT, where my small n varies from 0 to capital N minus 1. Omega equal to 2 pi by n. This is the simplest unit I have taken, 2 pi by n. Then you know that omega is 2 pi by capital N only we are taking, that is this particular smallest unit of omega in our DFT is how much? See, 2 pi omega is equal to basically this one, 2 pi k by n. So our smallest frequency part is 2 pi by n. So I am taking for the time being a low frequency signal, so that I am taking smallest frequency, that is omega into omega is 2 pi by n. So x equal to sin omega n, y equal to fft of x comma n. So n point fft we are computing. Small k range is also same as small n, that is 0 to capital N minus 1. So I have written k equal to n, I am plotting the magnitude and phase part. If I plot, we will get like this. Here, what it indicates, later I will explain. Okay, for the time being, I hope you have understood how to write a code for a particular input sequence, how to get the FFT, how to get the magnitude and phase part. Okay, now symmetric nature in case of DFT. This is very, very important point. Okay, so if x of n is real signal, real sequence, then its DFT x of k is equal to x conjugate of n minus k. The derivation I am not going in that detail, you can check in internet, the derivation is available in internet itself, or in any DFT digital signal processing book you will get. So from here what we can conclude, x of 0 equal to x star of n, x of 1 equal to x conjugate of n minus 1. Simply I am putting k equal to 0, k equal to 1, k equal to 2 in this equation, and I am getting this. X of 2, that is DFT for 2, equal to conjugate of DFT of n minus 2. Same goes x of n by 2 equal to x star of n by 2. x of n by 2 plus 1 will be equal to x star of n by 2 minus 1. Because if you put here k equal to n by 2 plus 1, here you will get n minus of n by 2 minus 1. That will result into n by 2 minus 1. Alright. So from here, one very important conclusion we can do, that is, we no need to think about the whole region, that is 0 to capital N minus 1. Only 0 to N by 2 is our point of interest, as I have told you. And from the 0 to N by 2, we can get the further after N by 2 plus 1 to N minus 1. See how and why? See, this is our DFT. Suppose n point DFT we are computing, then we will get capital X of 0, capital X of 1, capital X of 2, up to so on, capital X of n by 2 minus 1, X of n by 2, X of n by 2 plus 1, X of n by 2 plus 2, and so on. After that, X of n by 2 minus 1, and last will be X of n minus 1. Now, you know that X of k equal to X star of, what is the equation? That is x conjugate of n minus k. So here, see, from here we can clearly get x of 0 you have to calculate. Okay. Then x of 1, x of 2, x of 3, up so on up to x of n by 2. If we know, simply we can get further terms. Because in x of n by 2 plus 1 is nothing but conjugate of x of n by 2 minus 1. Put here k equal to n by 2 plus 1, x of n by 2 plus 1 will be nothing but x conjugate of n minus n by 2, let me put here x of n by 2 plus 1 equal to what? x conjugate of our n minus n by 2. Alright, minus 1, that is nothing but x of n by 2 plus 1, that is nothing but x conjugate of n by 2 minus 1. So that if we have already have this one, we can simply get x of n by 2 plus 1 by simply taking conjugate. Same goes for, suppose I have x of 1 and I want to compute x of n minus 1, those are complex conjugate pair. Same goes for x of 2 and x of n minus 2. So our point of interest should be 0 to n by 2, that's all, okay, nothing more than that, 0 to n by 2, okay, alright. So, now you can see here, this similarity as I have told you, what I have told you that after what you calculate 0 to n by 2 and after that you will get conjugate pairs. Conjugate pairs means magnitude is same but angle is different. From the basic complex system we can say, complex number, that is a plus bj, a minus bj, magnitude same, root over of a square plus b square, but the angle will be different, right? So now you just consider here, we have taken this particular magnitude and phase part, I have taken same one here, just I have written the k values. You just see, we have computed the discrete Fourier transform for which value of n. See here, we have taken n equal to 16. So 16 point DFT we have computed. So what I have told you, 0 to capital N by 2 we need to know. 0 to capital N by 2. Here capital N equal to 16, that is 0 to 8 we need to know. So as a result, what will happen? 7. So after N by 2, from N by 2 plus 1, that is 9, to N minus 1, that is 15, just simply mirror image you will get. 7 and 9 will be mirror image in the magnitude response, 6 and 10 will be mirror image, then 5 and 11 will be mirror image, 3 and 12 will be mirror image, 2 and 13 will be mirror image, and sorry, here I think I missed something, 7 and 9 is mirror image, 6, okay, 1 and 14 should be mirror image, okay, 4 I have missed here, sorry. Let me erase this part. That's what I was thinking, that why it is not matching. So 6 and 10 is matching, 5 and 11 is matching, 4 and 12 has to be matched, 3 and 13, 2 and 14. Magnitude response should be symmetric because
those are complex conjugate pairs. X of 2, x of 14 is nothing but x conjugate of 2, right? Because x of 14 is equal to x conjugate of n minus 14, that is 16 minus 14, that is 2. Now you see x of 15 is equal to x conjugate of 1. So see, that is magnitude part is same we are getting, right? 8, that is 8 value we are getting. Similarly, if you observe the face part, those are basically reversed. We know up to n by 2, then what I told, a magnitude will be same, but phase will differ. See, 6 at 6, it is going down, at 10, it is going up. At 5, it is going down, at 11, it is going up. Why? Suppose x of, that is 4. 4 means the conjugate should be n minus 4. N minus 4, n is 16, that is how much? 16 minus 4 is 12. See, at 12 the angle and at 4 the angle are basically reversed. So that we can conclude that as our DFT follows this particular property, x of k is equal to x conjugate of n minus k, so we can conclude what? Very important thing, that is, we need to just see from 0 to capital N by 2. No need to look further, because the further is basically mirror image. For magnitude response, it is even symmetric. For phase response, it is odd symmetric. That's all. This is very important point. So now, instead of plotting both sided spectrum, I will consider my signal for only 0 to N by 2 for this particular K value. Right? Now, suppose you have computed X in MATLAB. The problem is, in MATLAB, where you cannot take, after calculating x, 0 to n by 2. Because in MATLAB, array index starts from 1. So when you have to take your particular single-sided plot, then your x of k you should take from 1 to n by 2 plus 1. Just I have added 1, because in MATLAB, array index starts from 1. So I have added 1 in both the upper limit and lower limit. So our FFT which we have to take is 1 to n by 2 plus 1. That's all. So our single sided plot code will be like this. You will see clear all closal n equal to 16. Small n varies from 0 to capital N minus 1. Omega equal to 2 pi by 16. Same line. After calculating FFT, see what we are doing. Z equal to y of 1 to n by 2 plus 1. That is our, that 0 to n by 2 part, which is in MATLAB 1 to n by 2 plus 1. Because in MATLAB, array index starts from 1. That only we are taking. And k value varies from 0 to n by 2. Then we are plotting same. So this is our point of interest. And from this itself, we can conclude everything. Like, see, this is single-sided spectrum. So this is corresponding to 0, k equal to, and this is corresponding to k equal to n by 2. And here n equal to 8. N by 2 equal to 8, that means n equal to 16. So we are computing 16-point DFT. Now, if I ask you, plot up to n minus 1, what you will do? You will just take the mirror image of 9 will be mirror image of 7, 6 will be mirror image of your 10, like that it will go on, right? At 1 here we are getting peak, so similarly x of n minus k we will get one peak. Here n is 16, so 16 minus 1 is 15. At 15 we will get one peak. Simple, right? Here's also our point of interest should be this one. Okay, now very interesting thing. Determine the frequency from the magnitude plot. Suppose I have given you nothing. I just telling you, see, this is my magnitude plot and phase plot of my DFT for single-sided spectrum. Tell me what is the frequency of my sinusoid signal. Okay. And also I am telling you that the n for which I am computing the DFT is 16. Or if I don't tell you, you can calculate. Now, see, I am telling you this is single-sided plot. So this range is 0 to n, k varies from 0 to n by 2. N by 2 is belonging to 8, so n equal to 16. Like this also you can say. Now, you have to determine what is the value of omega for which the sinusoid signal, the 16-point DFT we are getting like this. This is a bit tricky, but simply you can understand. See, at k equal to 1, we are getting the value. For all other values, it is 0. So, k equal to 1. Omega is what? You know, 2 pi by capital N into k, right? So what is our n value? N value is 16 here. 2 pi by 16 into k is how much? 1. For k equal to 1, we are getting the peak now. So our sinusoid signal has the frequency of 2 pi by 16. That's all. Let us check what we have plotted. See, omega equal to 2 pi by 16 only we have plotted, right? So from the plot itself, we can conclude what is the frequency of our sinusoid signal. This is the beauty of DFT, right? See, here I have written n by 2 equal to 8 because you know this is single-sided. So n equal to 16, so 16 point DFT we are computing. Omega formula is 2 pi by capital N into k. So omega equal to 2 pi by 16. Suppose I am telling you, plot sine 3 omega n. Plot the magnitude, response and phase plot of the DFT. Code will be same. Omega equal to 2 pi by 16 and here x equal to sine 3 omega n. I am making the sine 3 omega n signal. I am taking the FFT and I am taking the 0 to n by 2 part and then I am plotting. But before plotting, can we do by ourselves? Yes. Why not? Very simple. Omega here, this is 3 omega, right? So 3 omega means 3 into 2 pi by 16. Okay. So what is the k value? What is the omega? Generally, what is the formula of omega? Omega formula is 2 pi by capital N into k, right? Here, this is into symbol. So if you compare, you can easily get k equal to 3. So at k equal to 3, we should get one peak in the magnitude response. So this corresponds to 3, this is 0, and this is 16 point DFT we are computing. So for single sided, it will go to up to 8. For all other, it should be 0, right? So this should be magnitude response. Let us check. See, very simple. This is I have plotted previously. See, 0 to n by 2 or 0 to pi also we can say because n by 2 when k equal to n by 2, omega equal to pi, right? If you check in, if we run the code in MATLAB, you will get the same theory and practical matching. At k equal to 3, we are getting the peak, and for all other, it is 0. So we can conclude, okay, our from the magnitude spectrum also, we can conclude our signal having the frequency of 3 into 2 pi by 16. Okay, all right. Now, very, very important observation, one particular thing. What I told you? Higher frequency is near n by 2, that is pi, omega equal to pi, and lower frequency is near what? 0, k equal to 0 or omega equal to 0. If you observe our magnitude plot of sine omega n, where omega equal to 2 pi by 16, we got the peak at k equal to 1. But when we have plotted for 3 omega n, that is when frequency equal to 3 into 2 pi by 16, 3 times of sine omega n, see, the peak is shifted towards the higher frequency or right hand side. I have told you, this is n by 2, this is higher frequency component. You can see here, peak is shifted from 1 to 3. So, this is very important point to observe. Higher the frequency, the spectrum will move towards n by 2, right? So, this is what from the pictorial representation, 0 to n by 2, n minus 1, n by 2 plus 1 to n minus 1, we can ignore because that is simply we can get from 0 to n by 2 because we know x of k equal to x conjugate of n minus k. But the point of interest, the point to be noted is this corresponding to DC frequency, this is Nyquist frequency. For low frequency, this region we have to consider. For high frequency, our region is near to n by 2, which we have seen also. Now, last topic, wavefront with two components. Suppose let me take now two components, okay, two sinusoid mixture. So, same code, n equal to 16, 16 point DFT, we are computing omega equal to 2 pi by 16, but one sinusoid is having omega as 3 omega, another one is having 6 omega, okay? Two different frequency component. Then, I am plotting the magnitude and phase part, okay? Observe it very carefully. If you plot this particular signal, 7 cos 3 n omega plus 13 sin 6 n omega, then for various in the time domain, if you plot, you will get like this. From this particular plot, can you tell me what are the frequency component in our sinusoid signal? No, it is impossible to tell what is the sinusoid signal frequency of our sinusoid signal present in the input. But if you take FFT, you can easily tell. If you compute this particular code in MATLAB,
you will get this particular response. And if you have this particular magnitude and phase plot of single-sided DFT, you can conclude what are the frequency component present in your input signal. See how? Very simple. At k equal to 3, we are getting one peak. At k equal to 6, we are getting one peak. So, no doubt, as we know, again and again, I am telling our formula is 2 pi by n into k. So, we can say one frequency which must be present, that is 2 pi by n. What is the n? N by 2 is 8, so n is 16. So, 2 pi by 16 into 3. Another frequency component which must be present, that is 2 pi by 16 into 6. Okay, see how easily from the single-sided FFT plot you can conclude what are the frequency component present in your input sinusoid. See, verify. See, 3 omega, 6 omega, where omega equal to 2 pi by 16. So, in our original input signal, the two sinusoid having frequency as 2 pi by 16 into 3 and 2 pi by 16 into 6, which we can easily get from our FFT plot. So, this is the beauty of FFT. You have one signal in time domain. You cannot predict what are the sinusoid components present. Just take FFT, single-sided, you can take. If you want, you can take double-sided also, no issue in that. From there also you can conclude. Same thing, just from n by 2 plus 1 to n minus 1, you will get the same even magnitude spectrum in the mirror image and inverse, that is odd symmetric phase spectrum. Okay, so see how beautifully we can conclude that although from time domain observing this signal, we cannot conclude anything, but from the FFT magnitude part, we can conclude that our input sinusoid is having 2 pi by 16 into 3 and 2 pi by 16 into 6, these two frequency components. Okay, so I hope you have got an overview of the insight of the DFT and how to visualize the plot, how to write a code in MATLAB. This is all for this video. In my next video, I will show you some more interesting property. Thank you for watching.